Okay, so welcome to the second keynote today, and I'm very happy that the topic is all around ethics in AI. So I'm getting most likely slightly more technical here, although I'm not an expert on that topic. I'm just here for Animesh Singh. He's written here down, Animesh Singh. He couldn't come, so he's based in San Francisco. I'm based in Switzerland. So climate change, no, good that I came and not him. Our center is called Center for Open Source Data and AI Technologies, which is based in San Francisco. It's formerly the Spark Technology Center, for those who remember maybe. And there are only two people outside San Francisco working for it. One is myself from Switzerland, another guy from South Africa. And we are paid for doing open source, so we are around 80 people. And we do exclusively open source, so we are number two contributor to Kubeflow, number four contributor to TensorFlow. If you consider DeepMind part of Google, then we are number three. Also second largest contributor to Apache Spark. If you still remember Apache Spark, people are actually using it in enterprise. I know the hype is over, but still it's very, very interesting and relevant technology. We contribute to Keras and another bunch of Apache projects, so we are a bit a Apache shop. So I'm not talking about a singularity here, at least not in a way as it's defined in Wikipedia, but I want to give you a citation of one sentence of that definition in Wikipedia, which mentions intelligence explosion and self-improvement cycles. And for those who cannot relate this, this is basically what deep reinforcement learning is doing. Okay, so we are on the track, and we need to keep the track favorable for humanity, okay, and not for large corporations. So I'll give you a little example later. So I'm a WhatsApp user, and my phone number was blocked, and I will tell you later how to achieve this honor, okay? So in the definition of Wikipedia, they are using the word unfathomable, but let's just make it fit to 2019. So let's use the word unfavorable for now. So what does it take to trust a decision made by a machine? So we are focusing on decision making here. And usually, if we are lucky, there is at least one human in the loop which is presented a decision created by an AI and then actually executes the decision. As I will explain later, in the case of WhatsApp, this wasn't the case, so there was no human in the loop, and then it's a perfect example of how bad this is. So there are four pillars which are important. One is the question, did anyone tamper with my machine learning model? The second is it fair or biased? I think you have heard a lot of that in the last 45 minutes. The next thing, is it easy to understand? That's also something important you will see later for my WhatsApp problem. And then is it accountable, okay? So let's start with, did anyone tamper with it? That's the term robustness. And as you can see here, we have an easy time to classify or to solve this binary classification problem, but a deep learning network might not, okay? So the question is, where does the neural network look at and where do we look at? So I think the neural network is just searching for three black dots in the image. But we can quantify this. So this is another example, a binary classifier between wolves and huskies. And if you visualize the area of the image where the classifier looked at, you see it was only looking at the fact if there is snow present on the image or not. Another interesting example is adversarial noise. So you have an image, you add a specific type of noise to the image which the human eye can't make out, but your classifier is fooled, no? It's misclassifying this image. Even for us it looks the same. A more severe problem is you can remove pedestrians from a video stream using adversarial noise. And another example is you can print a little semi-transparent foil and glue it on top of a sign, and then it changes its value. And the interesting use cases are if you increase the value, you know, that the car speeds, actually. Something about audio, you can issue stealth commands to Alexa. So in a frequency spectrum and volume and whatever, you can't hear, but Alexa can hear it. So I always put the publications at the bottom if you want to search for those. I think this session is recorded anyway. I'm also recording it and putting it to my YouTube channel, so you can just check those out if you are interested. So the question is, why is it possible to fool such a classifier so easily? And the reason is it's intrinsic to the way we are classifying it. So the problem is the high dimensionality. Some of you might have heard about the curse of dimensionality, which is always a problem for us. But here, let's have a look at a two-dimensional example and then just use our imagination to imagine how it looks in a high-dimensional space. So here you see a couple of examples. They are labeled. You have yellow and orange examples. And together with those examples, you have the 2D surface where additional examples can occur. So that's the truth, the ground truth of the space. And then you see the red line. That's the classification boundary the classifier learned. Okay. And you can imagine in a 2D space, you might be able to hit the true classification boundary, but in high dimensional space, this is more and more complicated. And therefore, it's always possible to sneak in false examples into the space between the true boundary and the boundary the classifier has learned. Okay, that should give you some intuition. In order to tackle that problem, we released the open source toolbox. We call it the Adversary Robustness Toolbox. And that toolbox just implements all the published work in that space for attacking such models and also for mitigating the attacks. It's a Python library, so I think presenting that at the PyData conference is appropriate. Then the second question is about fairness and bias. I think we heard a lot about that before, which makes me really happy. So I came a bit late. The reason was the very good breakfast in my hotel. So I missed that part. I hope you didn't bring that example. No? Okay. So this is a very, very famous example. It's from 2008. So that's the Hello World example if it comes to bias. So this is an algorithm called Compass, which has been used in the United States to help the judges to judge their decisions, how long somebody should go to jail, okay? And it just gave you a little recommendation. So still there was the human in the loop, but they found out that the algorithm was highly racist. Okay, you see here that Prisha is actually a quite normal person, so only minor offenses, but was classified with high risk, whereas Veron is more the bad guy, no, and his risk rating was only 3. And you see here, if you are black, you are just doomed, okay? So the problem of a racist AI is not always the problem of the AI, it's the problem of a racist world. So the cognitive bias we have is reflected into the training data we are using to train the AI. Luckily, as we have already heard, this is not only a problem, this is also a chance, because now you can have a look at the data our racist and biased minds are creating, and then we can quantify our bias. And not only quantify, we can also mitigate the bias. So we can compute or subtract the bias from our models using different techniques. So we are always using work which has been extensively tested and published in those toolboxes. And it's, of course, a trade-off. So if you mitigate bias, your accuracy goes down, but also the bias goes down. So you can choose how biased your model should be. So the important word here is quantification. And for simplicity, I've created I mean, it's not my main focus, but I just thought it's so complicated to understand. I've created a little Jupyter notebook for everybody, which creates the data inline. So I'm creating a data frame in three lines of code, the ground truth data, the biased data, and the non-biased data. And then I'm running the algorithm against it. And then you can just pick one matrix. This is the tail index, which I really like because it is a measure for biasedness between 0 and 1. It's always nice to have measures between 0 and 1. And then you see how this number goes down in case you are using unbiased data. This is all contained in the AI Fairness 360 toolbox, which is also open sourced. And then it comes to my favorite topic, which is also the most complicated. It's explainability. So I'm coming back to my WhatsApp example. So my WhatsApp number got blocked. I received a message that my number was blocked when I installed the WhatsApp application on my smartphone. And then there was a link where I could open a ticket. So I opened the ticket. So that was request number 38815. The answer is, we understand you are currently unable to access WhatsApp and we are working diligently to answer your request. We appreciate your patience, blah, blah, blah. So that was June 25th, 9:18 a.m. After 3 days, maybe this was just a request in the queue. Thanks for your patience and I have violated the terms of service. Here is the link provided. So I have looked, have had a look at the terms of service, and I didn't find any reason why I violated the terms of service. So I told them, "Hi, I can't find a reason why my number has been banned regarding your terms of services. Please explain. Thanks a lot." And the answer is, "We have reason to believe your account activity has violated our terms of service," which I already knew, "and we keep your account banned." And the last sentence, respond to this email thread won't be read. Okay? So thank you, WhatsApp. Did you notice something here? Do you think there was a human in the loop? I don't think so, no. Whether to block my account number or not, or in the response to my problem, I don't think there was a human in the loop. So I have a theory why I've been blocked. So I'm a huge fan of the Fairphone. This is the Fairphone 3, but I was using the Fairphone 2 that time, and I installed LinuxOS on the Fairphone. So this is a Google free version of Android. It mainly lacks the Google Play services. That's actually the tracking app. So everybody who is running the Google Play services sends continuously heartbeats to the Google servers about your location and your activity. So I didn't want to use that, so I installed LinuxOS. And WhatsApp even warned me that this version of the operating system is not compliant, but still continued to function. And the second is, I was playing around with that during my summer vacation. So I was in Portugal. And I guess the fact that I'm using a non-compliant operating system and a foreign IP just triggered the algorithm to exceed a certain score and then just block my number, and then the whole process kicked off. So the consequences for me, there are alternatives. Signal Messenger, which works with any phone number. If you don't want to use your phone number, there is a cool project which is called the Matrix. This is a decentralized, federated, end-to-end encrypted protocol, let's say email 2.0. There are many clients. A famous one is called Riot, so highly recommended. Another one is Keybase, which is even giving you a federated identity. So it's all so federated, decentralized. And at the moment, you get around $48 in Stellar Lumens of AirDrop if you install it, if you like. Not bad, it already worked for me. And it's even more sophisticated than the Facebook Messenger, because eventually the Facebook Messenger will support to send Libra coins, no? That's obvious. But here in Keybase, you can already do it. You can send Stellar Lumens, and the transaction fee is around tenths of a cent. So just use that one. And finally, if you are really a nerd just use BitMessage. That's a peer-to-peer end-to-end encrypted messaging system using the Bitcoin protocol. Just something for you to check out. Anyway, you see, understanding your AI model is important. But for those who are neural networks, you might have heard that neural networks is just a sequence of nonlinear feature space transformations. Have you heard about that? So feature space, so if you have a table, each column basically is one dimension in a vector space, and each row is a point. So which each column you can address one coordinate of one dimension, and what you then basically get, if you just plot the contents of one table, you get the point cloud. You usually normalize data first. That means in every column you have a value range between 0 and 1, or minus 1 and plus 1. So that gives a nice looking high dimensional point cloud. So depending on your problem, you have dimensions between 10 and 10,000. So worst case, you have a point cloud in 10,000 dimensional space. And machine learning actually is nothing else, or for example, classification is nothing else than finding a boundary in that 10,000 dimensional space. In the initial data set, it might be hard to draw 10,000 dimensional hyperplane into that point cloud to find a good line of separation. So what we are doing in neural networks, and that's the main reason they work so well, is we are transforming this 10,000 dimensional space. So we are stretching it and modifying it. And that we do in each layer, we do that non-linearly. So in each layer, we stretch the 10,000 dimensional space. And eventually, we have rearranged all the points in that 10,000 dimensional point cloud to draw a boundary between the two clouds, for example. No? Then we get a binary classifier. That's how deep learning works in three sentences. Okay? So the problem is, this is definitely a black box model. No? You even can't understand a single layer, a single nonlinear vector space transformation. In computer vision, I think we are using around 152 layers at the moment. It's a ResNet 152, so it's 150 times a nonlinear feature space transformation, and it's a convolutional network, so we have pooling inside, so we are actually reducing information, compressing information, and so on. So there is definitely no way for a human brain to understand what's going on. That's why explainability is so important. And this is the chart which should give you an intuition how to add explainability. And I will just pick two. As I said, initially, I'm not an expert on the topic, so I will just pick two which I understood. One is called the Boolean decision rules via column generation. So that's, as I said, all the toolkits we are using are based on publicly available work. So what this does is actually generating some sort of a decision tree for you. So using the black box neural network, using the outcome of that model, we reverse engineer another model, which is based on a decision tree, or which resembles in a decision tree, which has a similar, or at least it meets that accuracy. So it's more easy to have a black box neural network creating some predictions for you and then reverse engineer them. So that gives you a decision tree. And in the decision tree, there's a trade-off between accuracy and complexity. So you can define the trade-off or the threshold, whether you want a very complex decision tree with a good accuracy, or you can reduce the complexity and reduce the accuracy, and that's increasing explainability. Okay, so from the black box model, we get into some sort of a white box model explaining what's going on. Of course, you will never ever get to the performance of the neural network. For those who have been working with decision trees, they suck, no? On the other hand, if you take a lot of decision trees, you get random forest or gradient boosted trees, and they are more or less matching the performance of neural networks in many cases. On the other hand, you can't understand them anyway, no? If you can't understand 100 mixed and weighted decision trees in the model. So that's one thing you can do. Another example is explanations based on the missing towards contrastive explanations with pertinent negatives. sounds complicated. I tried to make it easy. In more simple words, it's telling you if you have this handwritten digit, this is a 4, and then you add data to it. Okay? So you turn zeros into ones unless you get a misclassification. So in this case, you just add random pixels until you get a misclassification, in this case 9. Okay? And that's a relatively exponentially growing problem because you need to find the minimum set of pixels which just predicts another class. So you have the choice of adding pixels at any place, and it's just trial and error, or you can use a gradient descent based method. And after that, you get a number of how many pixels you need to change to get a misclassification. And that thing you can present to a human. Okay? Because you see here, obviously, if you are like connecting the two lines at the top and joining them, that's a 9, no? That's really obvious for a domain expert. And that's the idea. No? The algorithm finds the minimal set of data changes to the original data to generate a misclassification and then presents the delta to you as a human. Okay? There's the inverse way of doing that. Instead of adding pixels, you can also remove pixels. And that's actually the minimal set of pixels needed to still get the 4. So if you would remove one more pixel, you would get something else, most likely a 1. Okay? So those are only two examples of algorithms present in the toolbox. Luckily, we have written a little, it's a free interface on top of the library to give you some more understanding. But it's basically trying to give you a way in understanding the algorithm by prototypes. Okay? This is called the AI Explainability 360 Toolbox. And it's all ongoing work, so additional algorithms, of course, will be added. And I didn't put a slide in there. We have donated all those algorithms to the Linux Foundation. So this is now under open governance, so that IBM cannot mess around the tools anymore without anybody knowing it. Okay. The last one, which is in the works right now, is the whole topic about data lineage. And that's addressing the answer or the question, is it accountable? So can you prove that you have done everything required by law or ethics to make sure that your model is robust and unbiased, explainable, and repeatable? So this is the topic about data governance and data lineage. So you need to make sure for each model you are using in production that you can connect it back to the training data. So training data changes, so you need to have some versioning here. To connect it back to all the algorithms, so you need to have versioning in the actual code executing the model, and also you need to make sure that you capture the versions of the frameworks. Now, TensorFlow 2 might behave different than TensorFlow 1.15. And then, of course, this also holds for the accuracy checks. So usually what everybody does is, at the end of training a model, computing the accuracy, but you need also to compute the bias and do the robustness tests, okay? One very, very promising candidate for this tooling is Kubeflow. For those who haven't heard about Kubeflow, Kubeflow is pipeline execution engine running on top of Kubernetes. And the cool thing here is that each node in that execution graph you're seeing here is a container running on Kubernetes. And that can contain anything. It can contain an Apache Spark job. It can contain TensorFlow, PyTorch, scikit-learn, whatever you can imagine. And that means you can have vendor-agnostic pipelines and also, if you like, vendor-agnostic tooling for computing those statistics about bias and adversarial robustness. For example, you can use the IBM library and another open source library and also compare the results. This whole stuff here is based on a so-called pipeline, but if you execute such a pipeline, then a so-called experiment is created, and all those experiments are persisted. So you can go back, check out your model, see to which experiment or by which experiment it was generated. You can have a look at the experiment, the parameters to the experiment. So each experiment can have different parameters. So those are captured. And also the original pipeline is captured. Okay, that's a very promising thing. And most likely we will base our tooling there. I can't tell you now because we announce it next month. But then we have the complete picture. No? We have tooling open source for robustness, fairness, explainability, and data lineage. It all is compatible with Python, by the way. Pretty cool. And that's just the selling the carpet slide. So since I'm from IBM, we integrate all that tooling also in our product, which is called Watson OpenScale, which you can try online for free. But the cool thing is we are using all the libraries which are open source anyway. So no closed source in here for that topic. Some additional stuff we have. Oh, I have three carpet slides, I see. So that's a pretty cool functionality. You can generate neural networks from data. So that's called neural network synthesis. But still there, we published how we are doing it. You can also check that out. Then those are my carpet slides. I have written a couple of books on the topic. You can check those out. I'm an instructor on Coursera. So I actually now lead the whole data science team for producing the courses on Coursera. This is pretty cool because I used to record the videos myself. This was a lot of work, so now I'm just having a team doing that for me, the content and the videos. And so that means everything which we put on Coursera and EDX regarding data science will go through my hands, so you can completely blame me on the content. Yeah, and the last slide is that one. If you want to check out what I've told you in our cloud, this is free registration links, and we are tracking you. So if you are using that link, then we know that you came from this conference. Just full disclosure here. And we have some time for questions, comments, additions, and complaints.
Okay, let's start with questions or comments. Don't be shy.
Yeah, maybe start with complaints. That's more easy.
Okay. All right.
Any complaints first.
No complaints?
No additions?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. So thank you so much for coming to Warsaw.
Thank you.